Well, hello and welcome to Lecture 8, The Politics of Business. This is one of two lectures that cover the 1920s, sometimes called the Roaring Twenties. I have toyed with the idea of trying to consolidate them both into one lecture someday, but there are some advantages to having them split apart, which I won't bother to go into right now in the interest of time. But let's get on with this part, shall we? So, basically here, change the slide. It says here, post-war reaction, 1919 to 1920. So think about it. We've been in this progressive era with all these social crusades and reforms, child labor, you know, alcohol abuse, etc., 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 trying to fix things there. But then we get tied up in another type of crusade, the war to end all wars, the war to make the world safe for democracy. And we're, you know, been distracted by that. So with the end of World War One, Americans very much would kind of like to just get back to business as usual, the mundane bits of life. Going to work, making some money, raising the kids, paying the rent, saving up to buy a car, interacting with people. This sounds kind of silly normally, but now in the situation we're in, business as usual sounds really good, doesn't it? Wouldn't you like to just get up tomorrow morning, hop on the bus, go to school, see your friends, stop at Whataburger afterwards for a lunch? It gives you a new appreciation to just some of this routine stuff. So very much people would like to get back to the norm. Now, one of the things going on at this time is some labor unrest. So unions, I won't say that there were no strikes during the war, but during wartime, it's maybe not seen as patriotic to strike. I mean, there's troops in the field fighting in combat. And so maybe strike activity drops way down. There's various economic controls that are in place, none of which we'll go into right now. But when the war ends and, you know, economic controls are lifted and things are getting back to normal, unions would like to try to make up some of the lost ground that they had lost during the war. And so there's kind of this wave of labor unrest sweeps the country. There's various strikes going on. I'm not going to talk about any of them except the Boston police strike. So the book may tell you some of these things. Let me see where we are in the book. I'll check real quick. Okay, I checked. We are in chapter 21 of the book, if you're using this edition that I use, the 9th brief edition. Chapter 21, particularly the first section where it says resurgent conservatism, starting on page 611. So, Boston police strike. Change the slide. In Boston, Massachusetts, the police decide to go on strike. The police union goes out. Okay? What do you think happens when the police department goes on strike? Crime heads up, unrest, that sort of thing. Okay. Now, they try to, you know, monitor things with volunteers. That's not going to work. At some point, if I recall, the governor had to send in the National Guard to, you know, serve as, you know, to maintain order. Okay. And the mayor eventually just fires the police department. All the strikers, he just goes out and fires them. Okay. They've deserted their post. They've left the public vulnerable. And so he fires them. Okay. Now, here's where he's got the name here, Calvin Coolidge. I've got a slide of him here. Yeah. That is Samuel Gompers. He's the AFL leader. Okay. If I recall, that's him there. He goes to the governor. The governor is Calvin Coolidge. So he's the governor of Massachusetts. He's not directly involved with the police strike, although he would have been the one who would have had to call up the National Guard, I suppose. And Gompers goes to Coolidge and asks Coolidge to, you know, maybe intercede with the mayor to try to put pressure on him to rehire the police officers. And Coolidge refuses. I've got a quote here from him. Let me find it. Yeah, I found my quote from Calvin Coolidge. Let me get you a picture of Coolidge. There's Calvin Coolidge. Here's the quote. He says, quote, "There is no right to strike against the public safety by anyone, anywhere, at any time," end quote. This makes Coolidge popular with the voters because he stood up to the unions. And he kind of has a point. There's certain jobs that transcend mere jobs. Police protection, fire protection. Those kind of jobs probably shouldn't go on strike and leave the taxpayer vulnerable. Eh? Today you'll normally see, if for instance your fire department workers had some kind of grievance with management, they would probably do some kind of work slowdown. Hey, we're going to stop filling out routine paperwork. We're not going to polish the fire engine. But we'll be at the firehouse. If there's a fire, you call us. Same thing with police. Police will do things like stop writing parking tickets, which gets the city in the pocketbook. But they're supposed to be there for you if you need them. It's just part of the job, okay? So Calvin Coolidge backs the mayor, stands up to the unions, and this gets him some national attention. Okay? None of this is particularly important as far as this one particular strike, but it introduces Calvin Coolidge because we'll see him again later. Now, during this time, there's something called the Red Scare. Now, red is the color of international communism. That's kind of just the color they picked. And in Russia, there was the Civil War after, the Bolshevik Revolution and the Russian communists were taking over the government. This war broke out between forces more loyal to the now murdered Tsar. And so it broke down into two sides, the whites and the reds, and the reds were the communists. Okay? So it's the color of international communism. And during the 1920s, there is a Red Scare here in the United States. People are worried about communism. Okay? Could it spread? It's already, absorbed Russia and toppled the Tsar. Could it try to spread? Let me get you a slide here, Ben. Protesters gather outside the Tsar's Palace of Petrograd, which is now St. Petersburg, in 1917. This is a little bit earlier, of course. Right. So, how does this tie in with American history? Okay. Well, one of the calling cards of the communists is basically one of the phrases is "Workers of the world unite." Remember, the oppressed working class will eventually rise up, says Karl Marx, and overthrow the moneyed class. Okay, seize control. And, that's actually one of their slogans, "Workers of the World Unite." There are people who are scared that maybe some of this labor unrest is being egged on by communists. Okay? Now, in some ways, this sounds a little paranoid. There probably aren't that many communists in the United States. However, it doesn't take that many to cause trouble. Let me see if I got a picture of the strike here. I don't think I do. No, I don't. All right. Let's say you have 500 workers go out on strike. Okay. Most of them are not communists. Probably 498 of them are just people who want a better way of life, better pay, whatever. But the way the communists kind of work is there's one guy in back egging everybody on. He's an agitator or communist, and trying to incite things, okay? Now, like I said, in some ways this sounds a little paranoid, but there's a little bit of truth to it. I'll give you an example. Everyone's always saying, how does history tie in with anything going on today? Give me an example. Why is this relevant? I'll give you one. Okay, so I was going to give you an example of communist work. I don't know if you've noticed, but the current president is not popular with some people. Some people like him just fine. Others are kind of in the middle going, well, okay, but there's some people who are really worked up in arms about him. And you've noticed that maybe there are some protests going on here. They started the day Donald Trump was elected, the day after there were people protesting against him. Okay, this is fine. It's your right to do so. If you don't like Trump, I'm sure you've got your reasons. But I'm trying to tell you how this ties in with communism and strikes. So, there's these pictures of some of these various protests that I'm looking at in the news. And there were people walking around with signs, the Trump-Pence regime must go, or, say no to a fascist USA, whatever. And I noticed a lot of these signs are professionally printed. You know, they're obviously been done in a print shop. I mean, they're not just something scribbled out with a marks a lot. So being an inquisitive-minded person, which is what I want you all to learn to be, is you know, to think about things. I wonder who's printing these signs? And so for a little while, I had this game. I would, when I would see these pictures of these protests, I would, you know, zoom in on them as much as I could on my browser. Okay? Sometimes I could read them and sometimes I couldn't. And down at the bottom of some of these signs was a website. Okay, there's been different ones, depending on who printed the signs. But one of them was like www.whatever it was. So I went to that website. Guess what? It's the Communist Party website. Okay? In fact, it's the Revolutionary Communist Party. You go to the Revolutionary Communist Party website, and basically they advocate for overthrowing the government of the United States. Okay? Now, if you want to advocate for overthrowing the government of the United States, well, you know, that's your right, I suppose. And if you don't like Donald Trump, that's certainly your right as well. But think about it. How many of those people carrying those signs were, you know, actually members of the Revolutionary Communist Party, which probably has, you know, a few hundred members nationwide, probably, right? But what happens is they go down to a protest, okay? And they're mad about Trump. And someone's saying, hey, would you like a sign? We have some signs here. Yeah, yeah, give me a sign. And so there's these people walking around carrying these signs with a website address on them from the Revolutionary Communist Party. They don't even probably have a clue that's who printed these things. Okay? These are people that my dad would have called. Dad was grew up in a different time. He would have called them unwilling dupes of the international communist conspiracy. They don't even realize they're being used. Okay, and that I'm giving you that example to show how it ties back in with the labor unrest. Some people are looking at the labor unrest and going, man, maybe these strikes are being spurred on by communist agitators to try to throw a monkey wrench in our economy. You know, and maybe the typical striker, you know, is just a union guy, but there's two or three people in the back pulling the strings. Now, this sounds like a certain amount of paranoia, and there probably is, okay? But it is how the communists actually operate. Okay? They try to get people dissatisfied with the system to where they want to effect some kind of change, etc., etc. So it's kind of their modus operandi. It's how they do things. And if you look at the communist literature from the period, I mean, it's on their list of things to do. You know, it's like, you know, bullet points, things we want to do. Number one, spread the communist revolution worldwide. Okay? So there's people in the United States afraid that this might be what's going on, and so this becomes known as the Red Scare. It's actually the first Red Scare, because there'll be another one later in the 1950s. Okay? People worried about communism.